And now the other side of the story. It's now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. This week, the Liberals will table their ninth straight budget with a multi-billion dollar deficit. The Premier and the Finance Minister may want to applaud that, because they have a history of blaming everyone except for themselves. They've blamed the federal government. They've blamed a recession that was 8 years ago. Well, the Fraser Institute did a recent study that shows that that history of blaming others is not supported by evidence, and that blaming the federal government...
However, I'll still keep doing my job. Please finish.
Mr. Speaker, the Fraser Institute study says that blaming the federal government or blaming a recession 8 years ago is not supported in fact. Given that recent study, Mr. Speaker, when the Liberals table their budget with another multi-billion dollar deficit and a debt of over $300 billion, what I want to know is who you're going to blame next.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, let me just be clear with the Leader of the Opposition and the people of Ontario that we are implementing our plan, and at the same time, we are eliminating the deficit, Mr. Speaker. We're doing that in a way that's fair. We're doing it in a way that supports economic growth and the creation of jobs. You know, Mr. Speaker, we are on track to eliminate our deficit by 2017-18, which is the track that we said we were on, Mr. Speaker. We have stayed on it. We have overachieved in terms of deficit reduction every year, and at the same time, we have made investments in people, in their talent, in their
goes both ways. Inches away from going into individuals and warnings. Finish, please.
Investments in people and their talent and their skills and the infrastructure that we know is needed around the province, Mr. Speaker. And at the same time, we are eliminating the deficit. We're on track to do that by 2017-18.
Thank you.
Speaker, I guess we'll have to wait till tomorrow to find out who they blame next. Let's talk about the facts. And my question is for the Premier. Every person in Ontario has a share of this government's debt. They owe $21,000 because of the Liberals' mismanagement. As this government debt grew, and grew it did, the GDP ratio, the debt to GDP ratio, has gone from 27.5% when the government took office to 40% today. That is astonishing. The interest payments on Ontario's debt has become the third largest ministry in this government. The government
Deputy
is spending
House Leader.
22 times more on interest than what it spends on the Ministry of the Environment. Mr. Speaker, my question for the Premier is this. Will you apologize to the next generation of Ontario families who are going to have to pay for your decade of waste and incompetence?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
I'm happy to look at the facts. So we have taken steps to manage and control our spending growth, Mr. Speaker, while delivering at the same time the best possible value for every dollar. Ontario has consistently had the lowest per capita program spending among all Canadian provinces, Mr. Speaker.
Wow.
And in fact, 2014-15 marked the sixth year in a row that we reported both lower than projected program expense and a lower deficit, Mr. Speaker.
Wow. Impressive.
We're doing this in a responsible way, Mr. Speaker. We said that 2017-18 was the year that we would eliminate the deficit. That is the year that we will eliminate the deficit. But I would remind the member opposite, Mr. Speaker, that as soon as he finishes his lead-off questions, his members are going to be standing up asking for more spending, Mr. Speaker. They're going to be asking for increases in spending, which is entirely inconsistent. Not that I would expect consistency from the Leader of the Opposition, Mr. Speaker.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, insults don't hide the truth, and I'll be very clear. During your time in office, the debt-to-GDP ratio has gone from 27.5 to 40. That is your legacy. That is your debt for Ontario. Now, if it wasn't for Liberal scandal, waste and mismanagement, this government wouldn't have to sell Hydro One. They wouldn't have
Associate
to raise
Minister
taxes
of Finance, come
on everything from beer to jet fuel. They wouldn't have to charge tolls for highways that Ontario families have already paid for. The Financial Accountability Officer, an office that you created, says your numbers are wrong. They said that Ontario's on pace for a $3.5 billion deficit in 2017 and 18. All the facts are against what your government is preaching. Mr. Speaker, as our final budget ask, will the government include in their budget tomorrow a credible plan, not a stretch goal, for a balanced budget and take immediate action to pay down the $300 billion Liberal debt?
Thank you. Premier.
We are on to eliminate the deficit by 2017-18. If you look at the Conference Board of Canada, Mr. Speaker, Ontario will be one of the growth leaders in 2016. The BMO said Ontario's economy is expected to be among the top performers this year. The Royal Bank RBC said Ontario is poised to be among the faster-growing provincial economies in 2016. Mr.
Bravo.
Speaker, we have a plan. We're implementing that plan. We are on track to eliminate the deficit.
Working.
The Leader of the Opposition, Mr. Speaker, wants us to increase health care beyond what we are already increasing it, Mr. Speaker. He wants electricity prices to go down, either by a subsidy or...
The member from Prince Edward Hastings will come to order, and the member from Stormont, Dundas and Glengarry will come to order.
He wants to either subsidize electricity prices or go back to coal. We're not doing that, Mr. Speaker. And he wants the budget.
Minister of Agriculture, come to order.
Mr. Speaker, there are inconsistencies in those arguments, Mr. Speaker, that are not compatible with responsible governance. We have a plan. We're implementing that plan. We're on track to eliminate the deficit responsibly and invest in the people of this province, Mr. Speaker.
Consider, please. New question, the member from Nipissing.
Thank you. Good morning, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Later today, we will debate our Opposition Day motion related to tomorrow's budget. We've presented three basic requests we believe the Government of Ontario should meet, quite frankly, Speaker, at a bare minimum. One of those key asks is the government put forward a credible plan to balance the budget and pay down our debt. The Auditor General, the Financial Accountability Officer, and even the CBC said there are consequences to perpetual deficits and the $300 billion debt this government has amassed. We pay nearly $1 billion a month in interest, which is crowding out the key services. Speaker, we see it every day in our health care cuts. Speaker, the Premier scoffed at our other asks. Will she at least support this one?
Thank you.
Speaker, well, we have a plan. We have a credible plan, Mr. Speaker. The member opposite will see in the budget tomorrow that we are on track. And he knows, Mr. Speaker, that year after year we have overperformed on our deficit reduction targets, Mr. Speaker, and that we're on track. It's true.
The member from Bruce Grey Owen Sound, come to order. I have now decided to move to warnings. I want to make sure that those that are talking over top of me hear it again. I'm moving to warnings. Carry on.
Mr. Speaker, the member opposite knows full well that for 6 years in a row we have been eliminating the deficit. We are on target to eliminate it completely by 2017-18. But, Mr. Speaker, I will return to the fact that the three requests that the opposition party is putting forward are inconsistent, Mr. Speaker.
Answer.
You cannot increase health care, Mr. Speaker, beyond what we are already doing, and lower electricity prices either through a subsidy or going back to coal, and at the same time speed up the elimination of...
Thank you. Supplementary.
Back to the Premier. Speaker, nobody believes a word this government says anymore, and is it any wonder why? They claim to have a path to balance, but the confidential gas plant scandal documents we uncovered showed they have a multi-billion-dollar hole in that plan. In fact, the Financial Accountability Officer confirmed what was in those documents in his last report. And the fall economic statement showed, plain as day, that they're using the money from the sale of Hydro One to make the deficit appear smaller. My question is to the Premier. Will your budget be simply more word games and sleight of hand, or will you present a truly credible plan to balance the books.
Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, not only does the Financial Accountability Officer recognize in his scenarios that our government's return to balance is achievable, he also acknowledges that the government is on track when he made the statement to reach our 2015-16 deficit target of $8.5 billion, Mr. Speaker. He also acknowledges that we're taking a responsible approach to holding spending growth in order to meet our targets. So, Mr. Speaker, we are happy to have the scrutiny of the Financial Accountability Officer. We're happy to have the scrutiny of the opposition party, Mr. Speaker. But I would say to the opposition party and to the people of Ontario, we have to have a consistency in the debate. We have to have the opportunity to say, well, you know, if you're asking us to do more in terms of health care and increase spending beyond, because we continue to increase health care spending, but you're pushing for increased spending in health care, Mr. Speaker. If you want electricity prices to go down through a subsidy or returning to coal, we're not going to do that. And we have a plan to eliminate the deficit. So on all fronts, we have responses to what the opposition is asking, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
Back to the Premier. I had hoped the Premier would treat the concerns of families seriously, Speaker, but apparently that's not to be. They're not even concerned, Speaker, with the appearance of consulting with families anymore. They knew full well the budget was written when all three parties toured the province on pre-budget consultations, Speaker. They knew that when they sent us out to work. Last week, the finance minister called our budget a fiscal fantasy. So apparently now, Speaker, it's a fantasy to ask for affordable hydro. Speaker, apparently adequate staffing in our hospitals is now a fantasy. How arrogant, Speaker, how out of touch has this government become? So my question is, will the Premier stop her doublespeak and begin to help Ontario?
The member will withdraw.
I withdraw, Speaker.
Finish your question.
Thank you, Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, you know, we are very, very concerned with the needs of the people in this province, which is why, if we want to talk about the electricity sector, Mr. Speaker, we have put programs in place specifically to help people who are struggling to pay their bills, Mr. Speaker, to get some support. The Ontario Electricity Support Program, Mr. Speaker, is for low-income families and program. That is why it has been put in place, Mr. Speaker. We understand that we need to continue to invest in health care and increase funding. We have been doing that year over year, and we will continue to do that, Mr. Speaker. But, Mr. Speaker, at the same time, we recognize that eliminating the deficit is a part of our fiscal responsibility. That's why we have a plan to do that, Mr. Speaker. And the members opposite will see in the budget that we have taken responsible steps on all of those fronts, Mr. Speaker.
Yes, sir.
I look forward to the support of our budget, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question. The Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier. In the last two budgets, the Premier has made deep cuts to education. Will the education cuts continue in Thursday's budget, or will the Premier respect the needs of Ontario students and stop the cuts to education?
Thank you, Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, you know, I just have to say to the Leader of the Third Party that what she has said is just not accurate, Mr. Speaker. In fact, the funding for education has stayed stable, Mr. Speaker, even in the face of fewer students in the system, which means, Mr. Speaker, that the per capita expenditure on students has gone up, Mr. Speaker. There is more money per capita for students in the education system now than previously. So, Mr. Speaker, the reality is we understand that having schools that are well-staffed, having school buildings that are in good shape, therefore having capital dollars for school boards to spend on those, Mr. Speaker, is critical, which is why education funding continues to be stable year over year.
Supplementary.
Speaker, I don't know what the Premier defines as stable. On Monday, the Premier said, we're not cutting education funding. But in the 2014 budget, Speaker, the Liberal government slashed $400 million out of education. In the 2015 budget, Speaker, they slashed $250 million from education. And the Premier's own documents, Speaker, say that she is now planning to cut another $250 million in this year's budget. Now, that's nearly $1 billion cut in just 3 years, Speaker, and it means closing more schools and cutting vital supports to students. Will this Premier come clean and tell the people of this province and tell the students of this province if she, in fact, will be cutting another $250 million or more on Thursday's budget out of the education file?
Thank you, Premier.
Minister of Education.
The Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much, Speaker, and I'm pleased to answer this question once again. This is actually becoming fairly regular. To make it perfectly clear, we have not cut the education budget. It is $22.5 billion transferred to school boards this year. It was $22.5 billion transferred to school boards the year before. And as the Premier has already noted, because the number of students has actually declined fairly dramatically, in fact, we have more money per pupil. You would be interested to know, Speaker, that in fact, over the length of our mandate, that the per pupil funding has actually gone up 59%.
Answer. Supplementary.
Speaker, the Premier and her minister seem to think that everything is just fine in education. But tell that to the people who have seen their neighbourhood schools closed, like the delegation that's here today from Harrow, or parents of the most vulnerable students in our province, Speaker, who are seeing supports like special education slashed. Or students who are freezing cold, Speaker, and have to wear their jackets in their classrooms while they're learning just because the heaters are broken and there's no money to fix them. The Premier may be in denial about what her cuts mean.
Stop the clock. Come to order. Please finish.
Premier may be in denial, and her minister may be in denial about what their cuts mean, but students and their families and educators see firsthand what's happening, Speaker.
Minister of Agriculture, Rural Affairs and Food is warned. Please finish.
And you know what, Speaker? The money lost from selling off Hydro One could lead to even deeper cuts in education. Will Thursday's budget stop the cuts to education? That is the question that this government needs to answer.
Thank you, Minister.
I'm very pleased to report, Speaker, that when you look at the record over the past several years, you will find that, in fact, the high school graduation rate in Ontario has gone up. When we came into office, the high school graduation rate in Ontario was 68%. The high school graduation rate in Ontario, Speaker, is now 84%. Not only have we increased student achievement, we have already invested over $13.9 billion in 755 new schools and 700 major additions and retrofits. And in fact, we continue to will continue to invest another $11 billion to new schools, major renovation and school consolidations.
Question, the leader of the third party.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My next question is also for the Premier. This Premier might think her health transformation looks good on paper, but for everyday people, Speaker, it is ugly. Nurses are being fired. Home care wait times are months long, even though the Premier committed to the NDP plan for a five-day home care wait time. I guess that was another one of the Premier's stretch goals, Speaker. Hospitals are closing beds. Surgeries are being cancelled. Will this Premier admit that patients are paying the price for her cutbacks in health care and stop the cuts?
Well, again, Mr. Speaker, as in the discussion around education, the leader of the third party is just not accurate. The fact is that the information is not accurate. The fact is that we continue to increase health care spending, Mr. Speaker. We are very acutely aware of the need for more supports in things like community care, Mr. Speaker, in mental health supports. And there is money going into those sectors, Mr. Speaker. And again, year over year, health care spending increases. So, Mr. Speaker, we recognize as the demographics change in this province, and again, this is also related to education, because the demographic shift is very real. The population is aging. People want a different kind of health care and a different different delivery, Mr. Speaker. They want it in their homes. They want it in the community. And those are the changes that are happening.
Answer.
Change is challenging for people, Mr. Speaker, but it's real, and we continue to increase funding in order to make that change happen.
Well, Speaker, either this Premier is not aware or she has her head in the sand. The fundamentals of health care are pretty basic. It's making sure that the care is there for people when and where they need it. But instead of strengthening care, people are seeing cuts to the care that they need. Hospital care is facing cuts. People are facing massive home care wait lists, and finding a long-term care space for seniors can take years in this province, Speaker. Is Thursday's budget going to reverse the cuts and put the focus on improving health care, Speaker, or is this Premier going to continue cutting and insisting that everything is just fine?
Mr. Speaker, I know that the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care is going to want to comment on in the next supplementary, but Mr. Speaker, let me just be very, very clear. It is our responsibility as government to make sure that we continue to improve the services to the people in this province, that we continue to work to get the outcomes on surgery wait times, Mr. Speaker, on community care access, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that young people who need mental health supports and seniors who need supports get those supports, Mr. Speaker. So when the leader of the third party proposes that somehow I am satisfied with the status quo, she is absolutely wrong, Mr. Speaker. Absolutely. Everything about our government is about finding ways to improve services to the people of the province, to build up those services, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that hospitals and health science centres and community services, Mr. Speaker, are improved. That's why
the funding keeps going. Please. Start the clock. Final supplementary.
Speaker, the Premier might be aware of what her responsibility is, but what she isn't aware of is that she is failing in that responsibility miserably for the people of Ontario. There is a serious problem when people across Ontario ask for something really basic, like making sure our health care system provides the care that they need, Speaker. But what they get is a Liberal government that keeps closing beds, putting hospitals into gridlock, firing nurses, and keeping people waiting for home care and for long-term care. The Premier's job is to work for all Ontarians, Speaker, but there are more and more people who cannot get the health care that they need in this province. That is the fact. Will this Premier acknowledge that health care is supposed to be about meeting people's needs and stop any further cuts to health care?
Thank you.
Long-term care?
Minister of Health, long-term care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, there aren't any cuts to health care. We're continuing to increase year after year the budget.
Thank you. Minister?
Well, Mr. Speaker, it's a good thing that I didn't remind the third party that they fired 3,000 nurses when they were party, or that they delisted home care from OHIP when they were in government, Mr. Speaker. But let's just take one piece of evidence to demonstrate the improvements that have been made, Mr. Speaker. The almost $2 billion that we've invested specifically to help reduce wait times for surgeries and diagnostic imaging, we've, as a result of that investment, we have saved Ontarians 282 million total days
that
they otherwise would have had to wait for these services. We went from the worst wait times in all of Canada when we inherited government from the Conservatives. We now have the shortest wait times in Canada, Mr. Speaker.
New question. The member from the TD Carlton.
Thank you very much,
Treasury Board President. Tomorrow, this government will table its ninth consecutive deficit.
Shame.
Overachievers, the lot of them. Borrowing more money than they take in and paying almost $1 billion in interest payments that should instead be intended for hospitals and classrooms. The Treasury Board President's mandate letter is very clear, Speaker. It says, quote, "You will work closely with your fellow cabinet ministers to ensure that our government meets its fiscal targets." Yet she is not. Both the Auditor General and the Financial Accountability Officer said this government has no credible plan to balance the budget. In fact, all we saw today was a plan to increase taxes, and that's not sustainable in the people of this province. Can the minister explain to the people of this House why she refuses to follow her mandate letter and why she is willing to compromise the fiscal health of this province?
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and I know we're all very anxious to see tomorrow's budget, and I'm sure everybody will be here and will listen to the news, and we will confirm that we are, in fact, on track to meet our commitment to balance the budget by 2017-18. We are doing it in a way that is thoughtful, that is disciplined, that is responsible. We are going through every service, every program, and every ministry across government and finding ways to deliver services better for people at sometimes at a lower cost. That work is underway. We are on track to balance, and we will all look forward to tomorrow, where you will actually see further details on our plan to achieve balance while protecting the services that people rely on.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, the fact is, the only thing they're on track to do is change our license plate to Ontario, yours to recover. Back to the President of the Treasury Board. She has one job, to find savings right across the province.
Please finish.
She has one job, to put the province back to balance. That's not going to happen, according to the Auditor General and the Financial Accountability Office, as well as their own internal documents, as my colleague stated earlier, that we recovered during the gas plant scandal. The only accomplishment, in fact, that she had last year was an across-the-board salary increase in the public sector. I need to remind the minister that every single dollar that we spend servicing the debt and the deficit is a dollar taken away from a child in a classroom or a patient in a hospital bed. Without a credible plan to return to surplus or balance, financing Ontario's public services will be compromised.
Question.
So I ask her again, will the President of the Treasury Board commit to this House for our long-term, realistic, credible plan, not a stretch goal, not an aspirational goal, a real, credible plan?
Thank you.
In the first question, we are on track to balance our budget by 2017-18, and tomorrow we'll reveal more details about that. But I have to say, Speaker, that this is actually a refreshing day in question period, because for the first time, the member from Nipissing has a question, the member from Ottawa, Nepean-Carleton, has a question about fiscal responsibility. Until today, all we've been hearing is spend more, spend more, spend more. Pay doctors more, spend more on this, spend more on that, spend more on this. Today, we did get we are reminded that there is still this notion within this Conservative Party that fiscal responsibility is important. We are delivering on the promise to get to balance. We are doing it in a thoughtful, responsible way that protects the services and enhances
Thank
the
you.
Service that people do.
Thank you. More question, the member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question to the Minister of the Environment and Climate Change. We all know that everyone is going to have to do their part to take on climate change. We also know that some are in a stronger position to help than others. In British Columbia, low-income families receive assistance from the government dealing with their carbon tax. In Alberta, the government's proposing to help low-income families with support that will leave them overall better off, even with Alberta's new carbon tax. Will the government support a new consumer rebate to ensure that cap and trade does not increase inequality in Ontario?
Thank you. Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. We are very concerned about two things that are tied into our plan.
One is that we achieve the maximum level of job creation in the low-carbon economy, because the world is going to be different and the economy is going to be different. And we, in our partnership with Quebec and California, will be leading the North American economy and are in job creation already before we've made the massive investments in building retrofits, in making modest-income family homes less expensive to live in, making transportation less expensive by our investments in public transit and electric vehicles and that infrastructure. We've already have $325 million out there, including subsidies for social housing and working families. We have already, even before our system is up and operating, investing at a level that almost no other jurisdiction is, Mr. Speaker. So we think that we've already really on the pathway to what the members' objectives are, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives and the Sierra Club recently noted that struggling families spend a higher percentage of their household income on home heating and on gasoline than those from wealthier households. These struggling families have less control over their emissions, particularly if they're tenants or if they lack access to transit. I believe that the vast majority of Ontarians, regardless of income, are ready to do their part to take on climate change. But the burden has to be shared fairly. What support will this government give to struggling families to ensure that cap and trade does not increase inequality in Ontario?
Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the short answer to that question is really an unprecedented investment in two things that cost families money: transportation and managing the cost of their homes. We will be massively investing in that. But, Mr. Speaker, we know this will not have any upward pressure on electricity prices. As a matter of fact, we expect a modest reduction in the cost of electricity for families in that area. We also know, working with energy and my colleagues in Municipal Affairs and Housing, we have already have demonstration projects out there that are going to help communities get homeowners into technology that costs almost nothing. We have a great nuclear baseload overnight that we can actually use to charge electric vehicles, Mr. Speaker. This transformation, though, Mr. Speaker, is about something else that working families need: more and better jobs. When we retrofit every building in Ontario over the next 2-3 decades, Mr. Speaker, that will be an unprecedented job creation initiative for middle and low-income families. Unprecedented, because it's easy to afford it when you've got a good income. Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question. The member from Davenport.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Transportation. Transit is an incredibly important part of life in my community of Davenport. My constituents want to know that they have access to transit that is both reliable and affordable. And while many living in Davenport have expressed how impressed they are with the reliability of the Union Pearson Express, I have been hearing from residents since prior to my election that the UPX should be more accessible for their families. I have long advocated for greater accessibility to the service on behalf of my community. That is why I was pleased to join the Minister of Transportation, the MPPs for Trinity Spadina and York Southweston, as well as representatives from Metrolinx, for an announcement on this topic yesterday. Mr. Speaker, can the Minister please provide members of this House with more details on what our government is doing to make the Union Pearson Express more affordable for my constituents of Davenport and for all Ontarians?
Thank you. Minister of Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. I want to begin by thanking the member from Davenport not only for the question but for her advocacy relating to this issue and relating to better transit for the people of Davenport. Speaker, since the UP Express first launched in June of 2015, it has been offering predictable and reliable service for passengers. And over the last 8 months, Speaker, it's become clear that those that have had the opportunity to use the UP Express love it, Speaker. It's equally clear to us that ridership numbers need to increase and more needs to be done to make this happen. And that's why I was pleased to join with caucus colleagues to announce yesterday that we will be significantly reducing the UP Express fare. Effective March the 9th, passengers using a Presto card will be able to travel from Union to Pearson for $9, and the cost for non-Presto card users will be $12. Speaker, these new lower fares will make taking the UP Express more affordable for middle-class families and commuters, and it will also attract more riders. Thank you very much.
Supplementary, the member from York Southwestern.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I would like to thank the minister for that answer. Yesterday's announcement was particularly important for those living in York Southwestern, a community that has long advocated for these changes. They were the first to advocate for these changes, and that is made up of people who are looking for fast, frequent and affordable transit service to get downtown. As part of the announcement, you stated that fares along the Up Express route will be better aligned with existing GO fares. This means, Mr. Speaker, that a commuter taking the Up Express from Weston Station can expect to pay $4.71 for one stop and $5.02 for two stops to Union Station with a Presto card. Mr. Speaker, the new fare structure is a very exciting announcement. The minister also mentioned other measures that will be taken to increase ridership. Could he please give us some details on that?
Minister.
Thanks very much, Speaker. Of course, I also thank the member for York Southwest and for her advocacy on this and many other issues, Speaker. As I mentioned earlier, we lowered the Up Express fare because we know that ridership numbers need to increase. But lowering fares is just one of the steps that we are taking to increase ridership, Speaker. In partnership with Metrolinx, we have identified barriers such as low awareness, ingrained travel habits, and impediments to ticket sales, and are strategizing to overcome these barriers. Marketing campaigns, better wayfinding signage, and incentive programs are examples of some of the strategies that are being developed and will be deployed to ensure that we improve ridership. I am confident that these steps, in addition to the significantly reduced fares announced yesterday, will lead to further growth in ridership, and I strongly encourage all travellers and commuters in the region and those visiting the region and members of both opposition parties to join with us, try the Union Pearson Express, because we know that once you do,
answer,
you will love it. Thanks very much, Speaker.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Lexington, Minnesota.
Well, thanks, Mr. Speaker. My question today is for the Premier. This government has failed to balance the books nine straight times. Along the way, they've piled up nearly $300 billion in debt and driven our debt-to-GDP ratio from 27% to over 40% today. That's a 48% increase in just 9 years. Interest payments alone account for $11.4 billion each and every year, money that could and should be going to pay for new investments and key programs. Premier, instead of reduced funding for doctors, school closures and increased hydro rates, Ontario taxpayers deserve a credible plan to balance a budget, including immediate action to pay down Ontario's massive $300 billion debt. When the Premier's budget is presented tomorrow, will she finally stand with Ontario taxpayers and have a plan to pay down Ontario's debt?
Yeah, Mr. Speaker, that that plan is in place,
absolutely,
and it is a responsible plan. What the member opposite is doing is he's including in one question, eliminate the deficit, which we have a plan to do. We're on track to do that, and at the same time, he's saying increase spending.
Yeah. Stop the clock, please. The to and fro is not helpful for me to stay focused, and I wish that it would stop from both sides. Finish, please.
Even though you, government, are increasing funding in health care year over year, pay doctors more, doctors who are the highest paid in the country, Mr. Speaker, pay them more, pay more into the health care system, Mr. Speaker, beyond the increases that we're making. And at the same time, he is inconsistently saying, move faster on eliminating the deficit, Mr.
Doesn't
Speaker. We have a plan in place. We are on track to eliminate the deficit by 2017-18, Mr. Speaker. But we are investing in Ontario's growth, Mr. Speaker. We are investing in the economic growth that's creating jobs today and is creating economic prosperity into the future.
Back to the Premier. In less than 10 years, Ontario's debt has grown by 91%, the highest rate of growth of any provincial government. Shamefully, taxpayers are now shelling out almost $1 million a month in interest payments alone. Later today, Premier, I'll introduce a private member's bill to cap Ontario's debt. My bill would install a provincial debt ceiling as a means to help limit and curb your reckless spending addiction. The Financial Accountability Officer has already stated if your revenue and spending continue as they have, that you will run deficits both this year and next year. So I'm asking the Premier again, when will you present a credible plan to balance a budget, including immediate action to pay down Ontario's debt?
Well, Mr. Speaker, we'll be presenting that plan tomorrow because that is the plan that has been in place, and we are on track to eliminate the deficit by 2017-18. But, Mr. Speaker, the reckless proposal that the member opposite is putting forward would lead to an inability of government to meet the needs of the people in this province. Let me talk about the things that we have been investing in, Mr. Speaker. The largest infrastructure investment in our history, $134 billion over 10 years. What that does is it creates 110,000 jobs a year, Mr. Speaker, and it meets the needs of communities to have upgraded infrastructure, Mr. Speaker. We're ensuring that all Ontarians have access to a secure retirement. We're protecting the environment through our coal plant closure and the new cap and trade program, Mr. Speaker. We are moving ahead, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that more refugees can settle in Ontario. All of those things, Mr. Speaker, are part of the economy of this province. The economy is more than a balance sheet, Mr. Speaker. It is the environment that we live in. It is the services that we provide now for people and into the future for our children and our grandchildren. That's the plan that we're implementing, Mr. Speaker.
New question, the member from London Fanshawe.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Transportation. We now know that the budget was written before Ontarians were actually given a chance to tell the government their priorities. It's too bad because this government might have learned something. The Mayor of London told the Finance Committee that transit use in London has nearly doubled since 1998 and continues to grow. That's why the City Council unanimously agreed last November to support a $1.1 billion investment in rapid transit. Mayor Brown asked for a one-third contribution from the provincial government. Will this week's budget include funding for this important rapid transit project in London?
Thank you. Mr. Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. So I'm actually quite happy to report I had an opportunity to meet with the mayor and other members of London City Council just this past Sunday at the OGRA Roma conference. We had a wonderful conversation like we have in the past about this very topic, Speaker. What I explained to them was that we look forward to receiving their detailed business case. I understand that the municipality is planning to provide that to us in the next few weeks. We will take that business case. We will do the same analysis with that business case that we do with any of the other transit business cases that we receive, Speaker, and we'll continue to engage in dialogue with the municipality to move forward with progress for London, as we do with all 444 municipalities as it relates to their infrastructure, Speaker. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. I also met with the London delegation at the OGRA and the Roma, and they continually mentioned that they didn't get an answer back from this government. So the government has pledged $15 billion towards transportation infrastructure outside the Greater Toronto and Hamilton area, but hardly any of this money has started flowing. In fact, people living outside the GTAHA, last year's budget mainly announced plans to defer transportation infrastructure to future years. London is the largest city in Canada without a rapid transit system. London is ready to put this money on the table. But the city needs a provincial funding partner. Will this week's budget include a commitment to fund London's rapid transit program beginning next year?
Yeah.
Thank you, Minister.
So, Speaker, I appreciate the follow-up question. I'm pretty sure the member opposite, being responsible, wouldn't want us to approve funding for a project until we receive and analyze the business case. And I'm not sure what lack of an answer the City of London could have suggested they had. I was very clear. It was a very cordial meeting. We have a great relationship, of course, with London, Speaker. But I think this speaks to a larger issue, which is the very ambitious plan that our Premier and our government have to build Ontario up, including communities like London. And, Speaker, it is precisely because of the leadership of this Premier and our London MPP, the Deputy Premier, the President of the Treasury Board, who has consistently stood up for her community, that we are making progress, that we are moving the province forward, Speaker, and because of their leadership, we'll continue to partner with London to make sure that once we get the business case, we get it right. Thanks very much, Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Brampton Springdale.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Government and Consumer Services. My riding is home to several payday lenders, an increasingly popular business model that offers short-term and high-interest loans. I understand that the demand for this type of business model is increasing, and many Ontarians do not have the option to borrow money from banks or their families. However, I'm also concerned for Ontarians who find themselves in debt cycles by relying on these services too regularly. My constituents want a regulatory framework that ensures they have access to the services they need without being subject to harmful practices. I know that our government took an important step by passing the Payday Loans Act in 2008, after the federal government downloaded responsibility to the province. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please inform the House how his ministry is addressing these concerns and what protections Ontarians can count on from our government?
Thank you. Minister of Government and Consumer Services.
Thank you, Speaker. And I want to thank the member from Brampton-Springdale for the question and for her strong advocacy on behalf of her constituents. I certainly understand the member's question with regard to payday loans and can assure all the members of the House that we continue to make progress on protecting vulnerable consumers. The Payday Loans Act guarantees that all loan agreements are presented in writing, caps the total cost of borrowing, and ensures that payday loans lenders cannot roll one loan into another. When certain licensees tried to evade these rules, we took appropriate enforcement action. And we also understand, Speaker, that with new technology and continuing evolving business practices in this sector, it's important for our government to improve legislation. And that's why we consulted in municipalities across Ontario and enlisted the advice of an expert panel to review the regulations. And we are moving forward with Bill 156, the Alternative Financial Services Statute Law Amendment Act, which was introduced in December.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister of Government and Consumer Services for the steps that his ministry has taken to protect vulnerable consumers in Ontario. Like many Ontarians, I am pleased to see the minister introduce new legislation to protect consumers who use alternative financial services. I understand that this legislation was based on panel recommendations and that the minister had asked the panel to expand its report to address services beyond payday loans. With an increased prominence of installment loans, rent-to-own agreements, check cashing services, and debt collection services in Ontario, it's important for new legislation to protect consumers who are using a range of alternative financial services. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please update the House on his recently introduced legislation and the enhanced regulations it will create if passed?
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. And again, I want to thank the member from Brampton-Springdale for the supplementary. As the member noted, the Alternative Financial Services Statute Law Amendment Act was informed by expert panel recommendations and extensive consultations with consumers and community agencies right across Ontario. If passed, the legislation will help protect vulnerable consumers by improving debt collection rules. It will help by capping the rate of check cashing. It will also limit repayment on rent-to-own agreements and limit optional insurance costs for added installment loans, as well as adding a 7-day waiting period between payday loans. Speaker, I'll continue working with local stakeholders and community leaders to ensure that we develop strong regulations to protect consumers in Ontario. This important work, in addition to our government's outreach to credit unions and banks as safe alternatives to payday lenders, will play an important role in protecting and educating consumers across Ontario. And I encourage all members of the legislature to support Bill 156.
Thank you. Question, the member from Leeds, Grenville.
Thanks, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport. For Ontario's film and television industry, last year's budget was a horror flick.
Yep.
Cuts to the production services tax credit and computer animation and special effects tax credit jeopardized future investment in a $1.29 billion industry that supports 31,000 jobs. Estimates put the annual lost revenue from foreign productions at over $60 million. I'm proud of our critic, Laurie Scott, who was able to amend last year's budget and delay those cuts, saving jobs and investment by keeping productions here. But the minister should know the uncertainty is hurting Ontario's ability to attract new productions and grow the industry. Speaker, will the minister provide the stability Ontario's film industry needs by confirming tomorrow's budget won't slash these credits again?
Thank you
very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to start by saying that how proud we are of the cultural sector here in the province of Ontario. It's a $22 billion sector, and we're extremely proud of it. We put those tax incentives in place so we could help grow the industry. We have our interactive digital tax credits.
The warning is still on, just to remind you.
Carry on, please.
We have our interactive digital tax credits. We have our music fund, which BC has just incorporated into their program. And, Mr. Speaker, we do have film and television tax credits. And, Mr. Speaker, we saw a continued growth this year, up about 5% from the previous year, in accessing those tax credits. So we are investing more money. Mr. Speaker, we should be very proud of our film and television tax credit, our cultural sector here in the province of Ontario. And I hope the member opposite will join us in saying how successful it is here in the province.
Supplementary.
Thanks, Speaker. My supplementary is back to the minister. You know, the minister's memorized his lines, but I think he needs a better script. He can't have this uncertainty year after year. There's just too much competition. Last week's BC budget reaffirmed support for film tax credits and committed the government to working with the industry. Yeah. That kind of support and stability it creates gets the attention from producers. Meanwhile, questions about the tax credit's future in Ontario is the number one obstacle to recruiting new productions. There won't be any more action if we think the government will yell cut. Only a multi-year agreement provides the stability to grow our creative economy. Speaker, will the...
I find it hard to understand that the first time I announced that the warning was still on, it happens again. So I'm going to remind this side. Please, please finish and wrap up.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My question is very simple. Will the minister form a working group with the industry to strike this agreement and make Ontario the premier destination for film and TV productions outside of LA?
Thank God we saved the industry. Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. As the member knows, we're doing a cultural strategy right across the province of Ontario. We have an advisory committee to me and to this government to talk about ways to really leverage culture further. But, Mr. Speaker, let's talk about music, for example. Last year, there was a Billboard Top 10. Six Ontarians occupied the top 10 spots at the same time. Drake, Magic, Shawn Mendes, Justin Bieber. Like, this is first time in the history of Ontario. We are so proud of our culture sector here in the province of Ontario. And instead of pulling them down and saying that we're not doing enough, you should be standing up and saying this government is supporting the film and television tax credit in the cultural sector beyond any government before us.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. New question, the member from Windsor West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Health. Every day, the minister gets up and tries to deny that Liberals are cutting patient care. But patients and nurses in Windsor know what's really happening. The Liberals have frozen hospital budgets for four straight years, and that's forcing Windsor Regional Hospital to cut 169 registered nurses, more than 10% of its RN workforce. Now, American hospitals like Beaumont Health Systems in Michigan have come to Windsor to hire nurses who have been cut from our hospitals. RNs are being interviewed one day and hired the very next. These nurses should be working in Ontario's hospitals, not being forced by this government's cuts to leave the country just to find work. Can the minister tell us how many nurses who have been cut from our hospitals by this government have been hired by American hospitals that are only too thrilled to take our highly skilled and dedicated Ontario nurses?
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question. It gives me the opportunity to talk about Windsor Regional and helping, I think, the public understand.
I guess reminding people of warnings is not good enough, so the member from Kitchener-Waterloo is warned. Carry on.
So in the first instance, we did provide Windsor Regional Hospital with $7 million additional funding this year to help them address their budget pressures, Mr. Speaker. But the important thing, I think, to understand is Windsor Regional is one of only a handful, only a few hospitals around the province that never made a transition to look at its nursing services from a holistic, comprehensive perspective, to understand that there is a role for RPNs, registered practical nurses in our hospitals, for example, that there is a role for nurse practitioners, that there is a role for RNs. In fact, Windsor Regional Hospital is one of the only hospitals in the province that has, up to date, a 100% RN nursing workforce.
Thank you.
They're working to change that mix so it's most appropriate for the patient.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the Minister of Health. The Liberals' cuts to hospitals are devastating for patients and nurses in southwestern Ontario. 169 registered nurses cut in Windsor, and even more frontline healthcare workers cut in Sarnia, Hamilton, Waterloo, London, St. Thomas. The list goes on, Speaker. Those cuts mean longer wait times for patients, more worry and stress for loved ones, and they leave our nurses feeling discouraged and frustrated by a government that just doesn't share the priority of Ontarians. And when nurses are laid off, families can't just pick up and move across the province to find a part-time casual nursing job somewhere else. Instead, these nurses in our border communities are forced to look to the private healthcare system in the U.S. for jobs they can't get here at home. When will the Liberals stop cutting our hospitals, stop pushing Ontario's nurses to take jobs in Michigan, and start protecting patient care in all of our communities?
Mr. Speaker, I did mention that an additional $7 million was provided to Windsor Regional Hospital last year. In fact, our funding in the last decade to that specific hospital has increased by approximately 50%. So the funding does increase, and it doesn't include other substantial funding, the $1.9 billion I referenced earlier this morning for decreasing wait times, some of that funding distributed to Windsor Regional as well. But they are undergoing the hospital. I think we should leave it to the experts, to the Lynn, the local leadership as well, is to make sure that the mix of nursing and other staff in the hospital truly meet the patient needs. It needs to be a patient-centered system. Windsor Regional is one, as I mentioned, of just a few hospitals around the province that hasn't yet made that transition, recognizing and, quite frankly, respecting the role of our registered practical nurses in this
province
and understanding that they do have a role to play in our hospital. Those are the changes they're trying to make.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Burlington.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities. Minister, our government has made a clear commitment to learn from the past, build on our success stories, and increase our efforts to help Aboriginal learners get the education and training they need. That is why it is imperative that we continue to collaborate with our Aboriginal partners to support the programs and services that are responsive to the diverse needs of Aboriginal learners across our province. I understand that your ministry has made significant progress on this front since launching Ontario's Aboriginal Post-Secondary Education and Training Policy Framework. Many constituents in my riding of Burlington, and indeed all Ontarians, are interested in knowing that our government is doing to increase Aboriginal access to post-secondary education and skills training program. Minister, can you please inform the members of this House on how your ministry is supporting Aboriginal learners in Ontario by providing equal access to high-quality post-secondary education and skill training programs? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Minister of Training, College
and Universities. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the member from Burlington for that question. I want to begin by saying, Migwich, our government is committed, Mr. Speaker, to providing high-quality post-secondary education and skills training to Aboriginal people in Ontario. Last year, we invested more than $30 million in the Post-Secondary Education Fund for Aboriginal learners and an additional $5 million to ensure that post-secondary education and training remains accessible at Ontario's 9 Aboriginal institutions. Furthermore, Mr. Speaker, through Ontario's Aboriginal Skills Advancements Program, we are collaborating with our Aboriginal partners to support up to 100 post-secondary and training programs and investing $3 million annually between 2015 and 18 in the Aboriginal Skills Advancements Program in the Ring of Fire area. Wow. Mr. Speaker, later this year, my ministry will release a report to highlight what our government is doing to improve quality and culturally relevant post-secondary and training opportunities for our Aboriginal communities. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for that answer. It is reassuring to know that our government is committed to providing high-quality post-secondary education and skills training to Aboriginal Ontarians. Minister, partnerships are at the core of our government's efforts to increase access to opportunities for Aboriginal people in this province. Investing in the talent and skills of First Nation, Métis and Inuit learners is one of the many steps of Ontario's journey of healing and reconciliation with Indigenous peoples. It is also important in terms of our economic development and our prosperity as a province. I understand you recently visited Six Nations Polytechnic to make a historic announcement about Aboriginal post-secondary education in Ontario. Minister, can you please tell us more about what you announced and how it supports our government's commitment to promote Aboriginal post-secondary education in Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Again, I want to thank the member for that question. Mr. Speaker, our government strongly believes that the First Nations, Métis and Inuit learners deserve equal access to high-quality post-secondary education and skills training programs. Mr. Speaker, just recently I visited the Six Nations Polytechnic with my colleague Minister Zimmer and yourself, Mr. Speaker, to announce that for the first time in the history of this province, Six Nations Polytechnic would be able to offer a standalone Bachelor's of Arts degree in Ogunwe-Howe languages starting this year, Mr. Speaker. I am proud, Mr. Speaker, to say that this standalone degree supports the recommendations of the Truth and Reconciliation Committee's call for post-secondary institutions to create degree programs in Aboriginal Indigenous languages. Mr. Speaker, this is the first step in a plan to offer a four-year Bachelor's of Arts degree in Ogunwe-Howe languages. Thank you.
Thank you. Good question, Members from Lanark, Frontenac, Reading, and Addington.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, to the Premier. Speaker, last week I questioned this government's commitment to protect women and their families from domestic violence after two tragic events in my riding left four people dead and another severely injured, and another attempted murder in Bancroft. These events, along with the death of three women in Renfrew County last fall, should not be seen just as red flags, but indeed as a crisis, and this government's inability to protect women and their families from domestic violence. Speaker, there is a crisis in rural Ontario, and when will the Premier provide more than just lip service to women and families living in fear in Ontario?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I know that the Minister responsible for women's issues will want to comment on the supplementary, but I will just say, Mr. Speaker, that it is in our very DNA as a government to make sure that we put in place protections for vulnerable people. The sexual assault and violence policy that we brought out, it's never okay, Mr. Speaker, speaks to that. It speaks to our recognition that deep-seated misogyny in our culture demands that we take action. It demands that we change public awareness, Mr. Speaker, that we put in place supports for victims of violence, Mr. Speaker, that we improve the judicial system so that people will come forward. And Mr. Speaker, I would suggest that the work that we're doing, I appreciate the work of the Select Committee, and
answer.
We are putting in supports for around the issue of human trafficking, Mr. Speaker. These are very important issues that we raised and we're acting on.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, again to the Premier. Speaker, last week the response was the Rural Realities Program was the solution. $1 million of funding over 2 years for rural realities. The reality, Speaker, is in rural Ontario, $1 million is a pittance without an ounce of protection or prevention for these women and their families, and it is certainly no cure. My colleagues from Halliburton, Kawartha Lake Brock, Renfrew Nipissing Pembroke, and others have offered solutions, but all the Premier's office provides are platitudes and a pittance in return. Speaker, when will this Premier wake up and fix this government's failings in our courts, in our corrections, in our probation, and our parole, law enforcement? These failings are adding up to one thing for sure. Families, many families in rural Ontario are living in fear, and you're doing nothing about it.
Thank you. Stop the clock, please. Too late. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Model of restraint, Mr. Speaker. I'm going to be here. I just want to say to the member opposite that had he been paying attention yesterday, he would have seen that we actually put $100 million, Mr. Speaker, into resources for tracking down and dealing with issues around missing and murdered Indigenous women, Mr. Speaker. I am very pleased that the member opposite has had yet another epiphany, Mr. Speaker. I am very pleased that he is supportive of the initiatives that we have put in place, Mr. Speaker, and he recognizes that there is more to be done. But, Mr. Speaker, I will not I will not take lessons from this member on how to invest in and how to support the women of this province, Mr. Speaker. The policies that we have put in place are groundbreaking. They are policies that are being copied by other provinces across the country, Mr. Speaker. There is more to be done. This is a decades-old issue, Mr. Speaker. We're taking action. I look forward to his support as we move forward.
Thank you. Thank you. The point of order from the member from Lanark, Frontenac, Lennox, and Anakin.
Premier, mean to say, especially.
Right. Sorry. Sorry. Be seated. Be seated. That's not appropriate. Premier, did you?
Sorry, I had a all of the introductions. I neglected to introduce Ingrid, who is here. She Ingrid is the owner of the Swiss Master Chocolate Shop in my riding at York Mills and Bayview. It is awesome chocolate, Mr. Speaker. And I encourage everyone to drop in and check.
Thank you. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.